あるとマイクみたいになりたい。でも電話してくれない。オークランドとブックレンドから世界チャンピオン、バーチャルプローズ始まるよ。よよよよよよよよよ。バーチャルプローズ。To my motherfucking man, 50 grand, an alcoholic man, and jack a tall can in his bloodstream if he can. Biggie Smalls, the 50 stroker, MC provoker, chocolate tie smoker, huh? I like to max and maximas and Acuras. Your girl butt cheeks, I'm smacking, huh? The raw rapper, spine snapper, with the little cuz on my lap. The ball, I ain't your fucking comforter. And if I ever fall in love, I bet I'm fucking up. Ask the fucker if I didn't chuck her.
Episode 111 of That World Champion Sound Virtual Pros Podcast. My name is Al, and with me is Mike, my main oos.
Hey, what's up, motherfuckers? It's Mike, aka Nothing.
You know what? Yeah, it was hard to transition like straight to just introducing you. That's it. I'm happy with it. Anyway, today's topic, the 2020 Shame Cup, a new set of world warriors have come to battle it out in the name of embarrassment. Hit us on Twitter and Instagram at VRTLPros. Peep us on iTunes, Spotify. Chat with us in the Discord, and if you want to participate, email us at virtualpros64@gmail.com. Mike, you put the call out there, and we got some emails, so do you mind starting off with that first one?
Yeah, sure. Speaking of not doing AKAs, this is another thing. I don't want to have to beg people for emails every episode. It's kind of embarrassing. I don't even like emails. It's just, you know, we don't do them, and then there's a whole segment missing, so... Might have to come up with some alternative segment. I don't know what. We already cover every possible thing a wrestling podcast could cover. So I don't know what else we could put here, but I don't know. It's getting weird. This first email is from DC. It says DC here, aka Moonsault and Pepper, aka DDT Roe Price, aka the Shooting Star Pressure Cooker. This will be a long email, so bear with me. It's not really a long email, though. I'm thinking about the 24-hour Dream Network. So for my day, it will be a Saturday, 8 a.m. WCW Pro, noon WCW Worldwide, 3 p.m. Kung Fu with David Carradine, 5 p.m. Captain Planet, 6:05 p.m. WCW Saturday Night, 11 p.m. Soul Train. That's not a 24 hours or even all wrestling, but, you know, what are you going to do? All of these shows are stuck in my mind. For me, it depends on the day. I still think about my childhood programming often, as I tend to watch retro content based on the time day it came on when I was a child. For example, Double Dare, 5 p.m. on Sundays, Beverly Hills 90210, 8 p.m. on Wednesdays. Have a good show, fellas. I dip into a lot of stuff I liked when I was a kid, but I can't say I ever sync it up with the time and day. I guess there's some things I remember. Like, I remember when I was young and WWF only had the Saturday shows. They came out at, like, 11 a.m. I remember that. And obviously, remember Raw comes on at 8. But then it gets kind of dicey. Oh, and Saturday Night Main Event was 11:30. Maybe I'll try that. Maybe I'll start watching Saturday Night's Main Events on Saturdays at 11:30 and see if it gets me to smile or something.
Where the hell did you grow up, DC, where Double Dare was on at fucking 5 p.m. On a Sunday evening? That's pretty wild to me. I feel like all 5 p.m. Sunday programming is either like NFL or like 2020. So,
you know, I might have got Double Dare late too, because I feel, I want to say when I was really little. No, maybe it was during the day. When I was really little, there were some channels we only got like during one half of the day. Like Comedy Central, we only got during one half of the day. And I think Nickelodeon, we only got one half of the day, too. And so I think it started at like 5, but I could be remembering that wrong.
Yeah, I feel like Double Dare, at least for the West Coast kids, was like always after school. And yeah, probably like on a really early Saturday morning tip, but never Sunday at 5. Any Sunday programming is like The Simpsons or like I said, like really scary, like adult like news programs, but whatever. Next email is from Ed. Shout out PBD, by the way. Wrestling needs more cocaine. Okay. Hi there, Virtual Pros boys. I think we can all agree that cocaine is the coolest and absolutely made wrestling better. Randy Savage, Hulk Hogan, Warrior, and modern Chris Jericho all had their promo game increased by doing huge amounts of coke. So who do you think in wrestling's past or present could have been helped in the promo department by doing a few lines before getting handed a microphone? I've been watching some 1998 WCW, and Bret Hart's I couldn't possibly care less about my job energy could have been even greater with a little nose candy, and I'd love to see Asuka's energy turned up to 11 with a few bumps before going live on Raw. Ed from Pod Van Dam, a.k.a. Brick Foley, a.k.a. Bam Bam Bigablow. I kind of like it when, like, square dudes get turned up, so maybe, like, a Lance Storm would be pretty funny to watch. Who else? Let me get back to you, Ed, but Lance Storm is my answer.
Yeah, I don't really know. I don't know if cocaine was always a drug of choice back then. I'm sure it helped, but Bret Hart's definitely a very good answer. He would have been a little better with a little more pep in his step.
Like a Jerry Lynn, maybe? That'd be kind of funny, right?
I think if you're just bad at talking, though, it's just going to make it worse, though. I think I would like to see a big fat guy, like maybe like a Braun Strowman all hopped up on cocaine, and then he'd be like actually menacing, because they kind of made him like a gentle giant after a while. If he cut like a hopped up on cocaine promo and then lifted up that RV or whatever it was when he was beefing Roman Reigns, that would have been the greatest segment in the history of Raw. So yeah, I think Braun Strowman on coke would be my favorite.
You know what the key would be is to have your interviewers do it, like a Charlie Caruso. That'd be fucking hilarious, actually. Yeah. Like, what kind of like questions would you come up with? Like, all and, cooked up. Yeah, that's where the real fucking money's at.
They'd be all sweaty too. It would be pretty good. And they just had the interviewers do it and not be able to touch themselves up through the rest of the night, just getting worse and worse as the night went on. That's actually a brilliant idea. I'm gonna steal that for Doggo Pro. Next email's from Abe. Says wrestling videos. Hey there, my sister-in-law has been seeing this guy and there might be potential in making him a wrestling fan. So far I've heard that he's kind of into professional arm wrestling videos and that he sent her the Invisible Man wrestling video. He's coming into town this weekend and staying with me and my wife. If the opportunity arises, what are some wrestling videos I could show him to seal the deal and convert him? This guy might end up becoming my new tag team partner when it comes to spending hours at the in-laws. So if he could start liking wrestling, that would be nice. Thanks, Abe Medina, a.k.a. Red Equals Green. Unfortunately, I think anytime this comes up, I have the same kind of answers. I think you got to go with the broad stuff, like the Orange Cassidy matches and the Joey Ryan matches. Although the arm wrestling part kind of throws me off, because that's, I think that's definitely a niche. That's not a normal thing, so I don't know what this dude would be into if he liked arm wrestling. Invisible Man makes me think he would like Orange Cassidy stuff, though. But arm wrestling definitely throws a wrinkle into it. So maybe find some wrestling matches with dudes with huge arms, maybe, or huge forearms at least. And maybe he'd be into that.
I think I have the answer for you, Abe. You got to show him a Scott Norton videos, mm-hmm, because mm-hmm. That guy, I think, was like a former arm wrestler. Yep. And he's a pretty fun one to watch. I think the only arm wrestling video I've ever seen, it was pretty fucked up. I think I saw it on rotten.com or like Style Project or one of those fucking old ghoul sites, where this dude was arm wrestling and he snapped the other guy's arm like right off his shoulders. It was fucking sick. Anyway,
that wasn't very good. There was a short-lived, one of my favorite reality shows. It was an arm wrestling reality show, but it only lasted one season. It was called Game of Arms, and it was amazing. I don't know if that's on YouTube or anything, but ask your possible brother-in-law if he's ever seen Game of Arms, because that's it's a really good show.
Next email is from my man Dan, titled Nerdery OGs. Hey, Vertbags. I was sad to hear about Larry Zonka's passing earlier this week. Just getting into wrestling in the era of broadband and Wi-Fi meant that you were bound to come across 411 and read dudes' reviews and learn something from them. I can't say I kept up to date with his reviews as wrestling media changed, but I consider dude a foundational piece of this passion and nerdery. Rest in power. On a lighter note, my fiancé noted that Hirooki Goto was attractive enough to be mildly real-world handsome, but is still considered wrestling attractive. Discuss. Lots of love from London. Daniel. Yeah, that was pretty sad to read. I think I heard that that guy left some kids and a wife. So pretty tragic. A lot of deaths this week in wrestling. So always a bummer. Hiroki Goto has really nice hair, though. I would say he's pretty ruggedly handsome, real world handsome, as a matter of fact. Yeah, I would probably lean towards that. How about you, Mike? You think Goto's hot or what?
Yeah, I think he's, I don't know. This wrestling handsome and real world handsome thing is very confusing to me. I think he's more real world handsome than he is wrestling handsome. So that's what I think. As far as Larry Zonka, it's kind of weird because, I mean, I don't know how old he was when he passed, but it's just because when I was like a young and first finding 411, I think that was because Scott Keith was on it, or one of the wacky news reviewers or wrestling reviewers was on it, and that's how everybody started finding it. And Larry Zonka was like the serious guy who wrote like serious stuff. And I just, because his name was Larry Zonka, I just assumed he was like an old man, but I know like he wasn't an old man after passing, but up until, you know, when this week, I just assumed always that he was like an old man, but he actually was not. Okay. And yeah, he was one of the better writers back then. Cause like I said, a lot of people gravitated towards the wacky ones and they're just kind of like, they're funny, but they get old. Or there would just be like ones that were like hyper nerds that were just like too hard to read because they had like actually no like writing skill. And they just, it's kind of like Dave Meltzer. Dave Meltzer has a charm to his writing, but his writing is rough, I think, if you're not a wrestling fan. but Larry was like, you know, he wrote concisely and it made sense and it was still like had a serious tone or, you know, not a jokey tone most of the time. So it was good. The next email.
Wait, Scott Keith was Netcop, right?
Yeah.
Have that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
He was on Ransylvania. And I remember like after a while, they like, I'm pretty sure it was him who migrated to 411 Mania, but I could be wrong. Next email is from Nate, I should say. What's up, guys? I've been digging deep into the DVD VR archive during quarantine, and between their 1001 matches and the Virtual Pros mixtape, I'm buried in excellent or downright weird wrestling. I firmly believe there's a direct lineage between DVD VR and you guys in terms of analysis that continually changes how I view and appreciate the art form. That's a high compliment. Thanks, Nate. The most valuable thing I've taken from DVD VR back in the day was a deep appreciation for early 2000s Big Japan death matches. What about you guys? Also, what do Yins think will be the Virtual Pros legacy? Thanks, Nate, a.k.a. Jerome Young's Dream, a.k.a. M-Dog 20 Matt Crossed Out, a.k.a. Trent Acid Mother's Temple. You know, like I said, thanks for comparing us to the Death Valley Driver video review, because, you know, it's probably my inspiration of having the ability to like wrestling and not be a nerd about it. I did like early Big Japan before I stopped tape trading. Obviously, that's where Tajiri came from, and he was like serious man Tajiri back then. And they had like cool death matches too. So I did like it, but it was at the tail end of me not tape trading anymore. So I didn't get super deep into it. I know Battle Arts was also really championed over at the Death Valley Driver video review at that time too. And it was something, it took a while for me to kind of understand what was going on, but yeah, I mean, all those early Hanma matches are kind of what I thought at the time was the peak of deathmatch wrestling, but obviously we've come a long way since then. As far as our legacy, I don't know. It's tough. It's not something I really think about. I would hope it would just be that, you know, you could appreciate wrestling and not be a nerd about it. That's what I hope people take away from this project, is that you can be a normal human being and still like kind of fringe wrestling. Like, you don't have to just like mainstream bullshit. You could like cool shit and not be weird about it.
Yeah, thanks for the compliment, Nate. I think it was episode 8 where we wrote our love letter to DVD VR. So like Dean and Phil Schneider and all those guys, like, I mean, I grew up reading those things. So it's definitely been an inspiration for this project personally. In terms of our legacy as the Virtual Pros, it's tough, man. I know, like, you've been putting a lot of Arjun on the pain pigs, which I appreciate. I mean, for me, like, anytime I listen to old episodes of us, it's always me really talking about Stardom, which is fine. I think Stardom, like, had a pretty good run. I know we were geeked out about, that 4-year run in NXT.
Mm-hmm.
I think, like, if people find us in a time capsule 20 years from now, I hope you can, take that away, as well as what Mike said. Like, you can have, like, a normal life outside of wrestling. Like, it doesn't have to be, like, your main thing.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully you guys, can take that away.
Did we announce what the show is? I don't even remember. Did we do that?
I think I talked about the Shame Cup. I think I dropped okay. that. I mean, the AKAs had really thrown me off, yeah. dude. I don't know.
This whole, you know, we're socially distancing from each other. We don't know what's going on. We're 1,000 miles away. It's tough.
Yeah.
But if we didn't mention this is 2020 Shame Cup episode, but there is one more email. Al, why don't you read it?
Okay. Wait, is there?
Mm-hmm. It's from old Wilf.
From someone unnamed. A couple things. No, I'm just kidding, Wilf. Hey, pros, I got a couple gripes and a question. Gripe one, Mike hating on bat flips. What the fuck? Bat flips are fucking great and an ultimate lightning bolt to a long-ass thunder-clapping home run. Nothing enrages pitchers, opposing teams, and old white men more than bat flips. One of the best bat flips of all time happened in Toronto in 2015. Joey Batstinger. Watch the link below. This is epic for a multitude of reasons that will play out in link, but the bat flip and attitude is fucking A+, GOAT. On top of that bat flip, these two teams meet again the next year, and Joey Bats gets the life punched out of his face by the second baseman, Odor, pronounced Odor. And then he sends over some links. Okay, bat flips rule. Gripe two. I don't want you to get canceled. So last episode, Mike kink shames men who want to crank off to find ladies doing mundane chores. Not very 2020. It's a pandemic. I've done the dishes 1,000,000 times. I will crank, mind you, this is all caps. I will crank off to any chick doing the dishes or any cleaning I don't have to do at this point. I'm gonna let that breathe, Wilf. Finally, and maybe it's just me, but I haven't seen any wrestlers that really pumped up that Plandemic documentary, which is kind of odd in a world of Brian Pillman, JRs, and TJPs. So what wrestler do you think is some basic bitch conspiracy buff? I feel like Corey Graves probably thinks he's smarter than everyone and would be some anti-vaxxer, flat earth, Plandemic believer. Shout out to Eric and Ilkon, Nights After Dark. Keep doing the Lord's work. J. Wilf. I'm a San Francisco Giants fan, so we play with respect, and I have never really seen bat flips done by my team. Yasiel Puig, he did it to us a lot, and man, that was really rough to watch. He might be a Giant this year, though, so all's well that ends well, I guess. That second part's for you, Mike. Do you want to talk about cranking off to fucking shores?
Okay, well, and first off, about this bat flip thing. First off, Wilf is a poser, and he hasn't even been watching Korean baseball. And I mean, they've settled down, but those first couple of games, man, that's all they talked about. They were like, oh, when are they going to show a bat flip? And it's like, dude, who fucking cares? They're just going to show it when they show it. Calm down. And it's just got annoying. They don't really talk about it as much as they did, but they're making it like the main event. Like, you got to come for the bat flips. And it's like, I'm sure I can just enjoy baseball without seeing this fucking bat flip. So I don't hate on them. I just think they need to maybe give more precedence to the actual baseball than the fucking bat flip. As far as cranking off the ladies doing mundane chores, we stick by what I said in the last episode. I think it's a very very strange strain of porn. It's not even porn because no one's naked or doing sexual stuff. It's just a strange fetish, I think. And I think we got to nip that stuff in the bud before it gets out of hand. Cause, you know, who knows what's going to happen after that. And it's just stuff like you start normalizing this, then dudes are just going to be walking around with boners for girls doing like the most mundane things. I mean, I guess Wilf already does that. I think Wilf just has a 24/7 boner anytime he sees a woman, even fully clothed or beyond fully clothed. So, maybe I understand why Wilf has a problem with this, but us normal people, you know, We don't want to be in a store and see a woman pick up like a fucking thing of Palm Olive and just like get majorly horned up over that. And I don't really need that. Is that it? Yeah.
Speaking of wrestlers who probably believe in really basic conspiracy theories, I can see Gargano being like that. He's a Disney guy too. So it kind of like falls hand in hand, I think.
I think Gargano's one of those dudes who has his head in the clouds and thinks everything's fucking fine all the time. I think that's how you get like that when you're like, oh, Christmas, and you're like in your 30s, like there's something. There's like, I don't know, you just don't, you don't feel misery like a lot of people do, I don't think. As far as I mean, he kind of exposed himself, so it's cheating, but obviously Jack Swagger, that dude's the most fucking basic bitch conspiracy theorist. I don't even think he gets into like the deep stuff where it's just kind of like, I can understand how an idiot could fall for this, but I think he's just like looking at like grandpa memes and falling for that shit. So I think he's probably the worst out of all of them, and TJP, because, I don't know what that dude's deal is. I don't know how one human being can be so fucking stupid, but yeah, Jack Swagger for sure.
Well, that was it. If you want to participate, and we're not going to beg you next time, email us at virtualpros64@gmail.com. I have a pretty varied two-man scramble. So my first question for you, Mike, as someone that runs the definitive Taco Bell podcast, what has like been your latest home run fast food item from there or from any other place?
We actually talked about this on the next recorded episode of Border Boss, but who knows when it's coming out, because sometimes they take weeks to come out. But I haven't had fast food since this happened.
No shit. Yeah. Good for you, man.
Yeah, I can't do that. I can't like morally do that, because there's obviously restaurants that aren't going to be around after this is over. And I kind of want to make sure I support them. I was telling Scott, though, that I was like few weeks ago, I was like, man, I'm going to get some Pizza Hut today. And I'm like, I picked up my phone and I was like, oh, wait, I can't. Like, I have to get real pizza and help out a real person and make sure they don't like have a job after all this. So I couldn't get fucking Pizza Hut. And we also talked about like how Taco Bell has just been putting out some real weak shit since this happened, which I don't blame them. You know, save the good stuff for when people are allowed to eat in your restaurant again. But they did that take home kit, which was like $25, and you basically got to make like 16 tacos at home. And who the fuck wants to do that? Who wants to take home Taco Bell ingredients and make it at home? That's just ridiculous. So there hasn't, I think everybody's holding back. There hasn't really been anything to like urge me to try it or anything. So I've been good off the fast food for a few months.
Yeah. I mean, for me, it's probably the thing that I've partaken in the most since this whole thing started. It's not like I'm eating fast food every day. I've been cooking a good amount, but like, I don't know if this is just a West Coast thing, but not Taco Bell. Jack in the Box, they started doing these loaded mini tacos, and they're fucking incredible. I don't know if you've had the tacos from Jack in the Box. I'm pretty sure you have.
I don't know if I have. I'm pretty sure I tried Jack in the Box while I was out there, but I don't remember it at all. I think I just had like not tacos, but from what I've been told, the Jack in the Box tacos taste a lot like the Burger King tacos, so.
I don't recall the Burger King tacos, but like anytime anyone has to describe a Jack in the Box taco, it doesn't sound very good. Like they're super oily. It's kind of like if someone took like an oversized like wonton wrapper and like deep fried it for like way too long, and it's super greasy. But they're just undeniable. So what Jack in the Box did here is that they made like 15 of these little tiny tacos, and they started making this thing called the avocado lime sauce. Pretty good, man. You should check it out if you're close to a Jack in the Box. I think it's pretty great. Next topic. This is a weird phenomenon that I've noticed recently. We're both kind of products of the 80s. Do you think sports cards and collecting cards is fucking coming back? Because I think it is, and it's kind of weird to see.
I think they always try, because, I mean, obviously there's these companies that make them, and they have to make money off of something. But I don't think it'll ever really come back, because it gets more and more expensive to buy these things, and it's not like because of popularity, like they just have to make them that expensive because they're expensive to produce. So I think, you know, older people are buying them, but at this point, older people also know the jig is up and they're going to be worthless forever. They're never going to be like, no one's ever going to hit it big. And I think that was the mystique back then. And they have those digital apps where you could collect cards on like an app, which is so mind blowing to me and so weird. So I don't think it'll ever really come back. I think people get like the pangs of nostalgia where they're just like, oh, let me check them out. But I don't know. I don't think there's many like hardcore collectors out there.
I was going to say, like, I don't even think, like, 6-year-olds care about sports anymore. Like, I don't really imagine them going to, like, Target and, like, busting open a pack of Tops and they're like, yes, I got Damian Lillard. Yeah. I just can't see it. And so, like, once I started getting these targeted ads for, like, these hyper-expensive cards, like, I know, like, if you have, like, a very niche, like, market, you want to, like, get all the whales and have them spend, like, ridiculous amounts of money, but I don't know. I just don't see it either, but it seems like they're really trying super hard in these trying times to have people care about a Marvin Bagley rookie card. It's just not going to happen, I don't think.
Yeah, I also think
I'm a hold though. I don't know.
I also think with the kids, it's like when I was a kid, cards were like a dollar, and I know inflation, blah, 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 but a dollar wasn't that, like, it was pretty obtainable when you were a kid. Like, you could find a bunch of change and amount to a dollar. Kids aren't finding $5 worth of change now, so it's hard to just be like, oh, fuck, I'm gonna find a dollar and then go buy some cards. And plus, you're a kid. You have the internet. Like, finding a dollar and buying cards takes like 4 hours in the 80s. So, you can just look on the internet for 4 hours and be much more entertained.
So did you finish The Last Dance at all or no?
Yes, I did. I finished it.
So what were your main takeaways? I just wanted to ask whether or not you thought Michael Jordan pushed off at the end or what.
I don't think he did. I think, they show it. I mean, he has his hand there, but he doesn't. I don't know. I'm so bad at telling basketball fouls because the stuff I see, I'm just like, oh, fuck. Like, it's always such a little tap. I don't think the force he put into that would really move a man. So I don't know. I think that dude was already wobbly. So I don't really think he pushed him.
Same thing, man. He was on fucking roller skates, dude. He was like a baby deer out there. And the way that Michael Jordan fucking crossed him over, it was beautiful. Apparently, they're producing for their next long-form like documentary series a story about the Patriots and their run in the past 20 years. Do you have any interest in that at all?
No. I don't want to see that. That's terrible. That's no one wants to see that. See,
go ahead.
The thing that separates Mike, there's several things that separate Michael Jordan, why they can do such a documentary. One is that he's kind of been a closed off dude for so long, and he played basketball in an era where, it was okay to be like, it was okay to be closed off because you didn't have fucking social media or anything. So it was okay to not know a dude's business. And, he's kind of gotten this reputation over the past 20 or some years that he's kind of been a prick. So this kind of doing this humanizing documentary works because it's like, oh, he has a heart after all, even though people can debate that from the documentary. But, they did the same thing with Mike Tyson like 5 or 6 years ago, and it worked wonders for him too because everybody forgot he's a rapist or an accused rapist, I should say, that did his time. But, you know, no one really talks about that anymore because they did a humanizing documentary. And I think that's what they try to do with this Michael Jordan thing. And I'm sure it worked to an extent, but, and the whole story is like, even if you for some reason don't believe he's the best basketball player of all time, he still has the best story. Like, if you want to argue LeBron is the best basketball player of all time, he played for several different teams. Like, he hopped around. He kind of backstabbed his home team. He came back. Michael Jordan did this all with one team. And it, like, I was a kid back then, but even, I don't know. I'm sure fucking adults are assholes, but like, most kids, if the Bulls weren't their favorite team, like, they still liked Michael Jordan. They still loved Michael Jordan. And I don't think anybody loves the Patriots except Patriots fans. So it's kind of hard. Like, they're not this universal beloved character. So, I think, like, me and Doan and Sawyer were talking about it too. And I don't know. I don't think there's anybody they could do it with that's so, like, as flawless as Michael Jordan. I don't think there's anybody left. And, like, outside of sports, maybe you could do one on, like, Madonna or something, but can't do it on Michael Jackson. Can't do it on Prince. So, like, there's very few people that have been notoriously closed off their whole lives that were just like always have been like the highest echelon of popularity and stardom that you could be. So I think I don't think the Patriots one's going to be as well liked as Michael Jordan.
I was going to say, I feel like Patriots fandom is so regional that, like, Tom Brady is not, like, a cultural icon, no. Like, not even close to the level of Jordan. And, like, what are they going to talk about for 10 hours? Like, how he kisses his kid on the lips? Like, who cares? Like, I guess, like, you know, they were like, yeah, obviously, like, the best football team. Yeah, probably ever, I suppose. I guess on, like, a franchise level. But I would never watch an hour of that, let alone 10.
Yeah.
Next up, Switch Chat. You and I both bought Super Mega League Baseball 3. What are your thoughts?
I think it's pretty good. I remember my friend Aaron told me about it last year when Part 2 came out, and he like texted me, and I think it was when I was in New York doing work, and I did not have my Switch with me. And he's like, oh, you gotta check this game out. It's like Baseball Stars, but new. And for those of you who don't know, which is probably everybody out there, but Baseball Stars is one of my all-time favorite Nintendo games. It's probably in the top three. I love Baseball Stars, so I was like, oh, shit, I'll check that out. And I think by the time I got home in order to check it out, I was already had forgotten about it until Al brought up that Part 3 came out. So I was like, oh, it's perfect timing. I'm not doing anything else. Yeah, I like it. It's kind of on the like you don't have to care about baseball. There's no real teams. It's not super, it's like, it just has enough simulation in it where it's not super corny, and it doesn't have too much simulation where it's too complicated and stressful, because I think that's the main problem with a lot of sports games these days, is that they get too complex where it's just stressful to just pick up and play. And this kind of has that solved. They also have customizable seasons and franchises, so if you're like me, and you can't stand to play fucking 9 innings of one baseball game, you could shorten it to 6 innings. You could do whatever the hell you want. You could change the fucking conferences and the divisions and change the names and do everything. It's super customizable. I think the gripes I would have aren't really much. And there's also 99 separate difficulty levels. So you can't even be like, oh, it's too easy or oh, it's too hard, because you have your pick of the litter. I do wish they did have an arcade mode, though, like a mode with power-ups that you could turn on and off, because I think that would add like a whole other level of playability to it. I mean, I'm glad they chose no power-ups, because I'd rather play like kind of regular baseball that's casual. But I would like, I think if they do Super Mega Baseball 4, they should think about adding it. I've also read, because I've been reading like reviews of it and stuff, that they've been kind of continuing, and it's been kind of the same characters since like the first one, and like one guy's getting older and like shit like that. So I think that's pretty cool that they're creating their own little Super Mega Baseball universe. But yeah, if you have a Switch, or even it's on any console, actually, it's $45, which is semi cheap. And if you're looking for a sports game that you don't have to like be a total nerd over and like learn a whole new thing, you should check it out. It has a demo, and it's free to play online if you have the demo. So it's like you kind of get a free game if you're real cheap and you don't have any interest in playing anything else.
Yeah, for me, I've been fiending for a baseball game for a while, and since there's no actual real baseball to watch, I mean, KBO kind of counts, but not really. When this dropped,
you shut your mouth
about it. I don't even know how the Doosan Bears are doing right now. So,
oh well, let me tell you, Al. They've currently been playing the best team, the NC Dinos. They won their game yesterday in the 11th, the bottom of the 11th, which was a heartbreaker because I'm waiting to see a tie, and they tie after 12 innings. But today, they're going to the ninth inning, beating the Dinos 5-4. No, I think they were beating them 5-3, and then it got down to 2 outs, and it was 5-4. And fucking the Dinos put the switch on and beat them 12-5 at the end, all with with only having one out, playing on one out, like a game of Super Mega Baseball, basically. So if you like Super Mega Baseball, you would definitely like Korean baseball, because it's kind of the same thing. I think they explained it that they don't have any closers in Korean baseball. Like, it's just you get old and they move you to like the later innings. So, because you don't have, like, you don't have it in you anymore to play more innings. So most of the games I've seen have a lot of late inning action, because the pitchers are just dead by then.
But yeah, I think the Baseball Stars comparison is pretty apt. Like, it has that right amount of campiness. Like, there was a player called Hito Moonshata that I'm trying to get on my team. I don't know how to trade yet, but he's going to be a blowfish soon. But I really feel like when I saw the $45 prize tag, I was like, I don't know, man. This is like a very PC-looking game.
Yeah.
It's pretty ugly.
I mean, even even when you boot it up and the menu screen comes on, it's like, ugh. Like, it looks just like...
Yeah.
Like, it just looks like you got fucking bamboozled out of your money.
Yeah, it has that really, like, ugly PC, like, Rocket League style to it that's not very charming at all. Like, it's made with that Unreal Engine or whatever the fuck it is that every game was, like... It's like a Gears of War, like, type game. I don't know. I can't really explain it well. But the gameplay is really sharp. I like it a lot. I've been playing a lot of online Pennant Race, and that's been fun. I think my takeaway from online play is that if someone gets a single... they're going to try to stretch it out to a triple because everyone steals. And you really got to get good at that. And I've been getting punished lately. So that hasn't been fun, but I know I'm getting stronger at it. But overall, if you like baseball games, it's definitely worth a poke. Since we are a wrestling podcast, though, I guess I'll have my last topic be about wrestling. I'm also assuming that you watched the last episode of Dark Side of the Ring. What were your takeaways from that?
I thought it was pretty good. You know, definitely pretty heart-wrenching. They were going to go fucking hard on the WWF and Vince McMahon and stuff. And I mean, you know, they laid it out, but they didn't really... I thought it was going to be just like a whole shit fest on them, but it really wasn't. It was more about Owen Hart and his legacy, which was cool. It's good to see, like, his kids seem pretty adjusted and, you know, his wife is, you know, doing what she can. I even thought, like, it was good to, like, kind of limit it to Jim Cornette and JR. And, you know, like, I think they had the Godfather speak for a minute. Like, it wasn't, they didn't have, like, you know, just some fucking guy who shared a locker room with Owen Hart for a few months talking. So they limited, like, people really knew him and knew the story. And, yeah, I think it was a really good job. I don't know if it was my most favorite one, but... It was definitely, it was very tasteful, and I think they did a good job without making it like a complete hit piece on the WWF.
Yeah, for me, like, it really humanized Owen Hart, as well, like, aside from just what I know of him as a wrestler. Once I saw that they got into the pay-per-view, like, 20 minutes into the episode, I was like, man, this should have been a two-parter.
Yeah.
I thought it could have benefited from that. But I think my biggest takeaway was Jim Ross talking about Kevin Dunn when they were on the headset. And Kevin Dunn was just like, he's dead. You're back on the air in 10, 9. Yeah. And I was like, what the fuck, dude?
Yeah.
This company's fucking soulless.
That's why.
And then I was listening.
That's why it's so crazy they didn't, like... Like, they mention this, and obviously you're left with, unless you're a complete toilet person, like some people on the internet are, like, just the way they, you know, just the way they describe it and everything, you're obviously like, wow, that is, like, a horrible company, but they didn't feel the need to say, hey, this is how horrible WWF is. So it's pretty cool they presented it that way.
And then I heard later on today that WCW had written a story for Brett.
Yeah.
Where he walks on a catwalk.
Yeah.
And then I started to question doing this show and watching wrestling from here on out.
And they did the thing.
Here we are doing the Shane Cup.
And they did the thing with Canyon falling off the fucking cage at the same arena, you know, like a year later or whatever it was. And it's just like, that's why we have to deal with these wrestling fans that are just like broken human beings that are just like, oh, Martha Hart is ruining Owen's legacy. Like, dude, you work at like a fucking Jiffy Lube. What do you even know about like wrestling or anything? And like, if you're saying this about a woman that you don't know, like, how do you treat women in your life? Like, you must be the most wretched, awful piece of shit person. So if you are a person who believes that, please just shut this off.
I was going to say, a lot of people asked about Martha Hart harassers and how well they would place into the Shame Cup. And listen, we wanted to make this tournament like as competitive as possible. And if we had that entry, it would be like a 20-minute episode. It wouldn't be very fun at all. But yeah, overall, worth a watch if you haven't seen it already. That was it for me.
Yeah, I just want to say what Al just said, that this is a wrestling podcast, and I know this is the episode where we get the most new listeners on, so if you haven't tuned out now between video game baseball talk and just random food talk, we do cover wrestling, but, you know, you might have looked outside and there's some weird shit going on. So for the past few episodes, we've been kind of branching out into other topics because watching wrestling now kind of sucks because there's no crowd. And
oh, it's horrible. I hate it, dude. I can't watch AEW or NXT.
Yeah.
Fucking New Japan isn't even a thing right now. Stardom as well. What am I doing right now with this?
Yeah. I watch AEW, but I'm like, it's definitely not with the attention I watched it beforehand. I'm gonna probably watch the pay-per-view this weekend, but it's not like if I missed it, it wouldn't matter. And I don't even know what's going on WWE. But you know, I guess I could make this my first topic. Is so because of this, I started doing these little compilations called Pain Pigs on Twitch every Monday. And the next one from this episode is supposed to be the last one, mostly because these do take a little time. I'm not Mr. Video Editor Extraordinaire. I kind of just learned it just to make these. So these do take time, and I do expect to go back to work at some point in my life. Like, I'm working from home, but I assume someone's going to force me to go back into an office at some point. So I don't want to just like sit around making these every week because it's going to be time consuming once I have to start commuting and shit like that. But so for now, this is the last one. I did think if you've been watching, if you haven't, they're on every Monday at 9 p.m. Not every Monday. This is the last one, I guess. This Monday at 9 p.m. on our Twitch. That can be found at VRTL Pros, 9 p.m. Eastern, that is. But I think after this one, I'm going to do one more that's going to be like a B-sides of just all the stuff that I just didn't get around to using. So you'll have that to look forward to if you like the series. It's something that's kind of surprised me because I expected it to be like one of those things that I do where get a good amount of people for the first one and then just gradually get lower and lower. But it's the opposite. They keep getting more and more people watching them. So that's kind of cool. So might as well stop when it's at its peak. And but, you know, I don't know. Like I said, I don't know how long I'm going to be home not going to an office. So maybe I'll do one once every couple weeks or once a month. So if you're enjoying it, I also might do a marathon one day, just let it run for like 10 hours or whatever, however long it is to just do it. But, yeah, so if you've been enjoying it, I'll probably continue in some form, just probably not every week.
I'm excited for it. Yeah. I tune in every Monday to watch it, and you're doing such a good job. So I hope you continue with it. I mean, the B-sides episode sounds pretty good.
Yeah. There's some not safe for work Joshi stuff on there that I was like, I don't want to put this in any of this because it's kind of sleazy. So now
really excited. Yeah. Wolf too, just rubbing his hands right now. Dude.
Yeah,
are they washing dishes or what? What are they doing?
They're definitely
they
washing
fucking at Home Depot looking for hardware or what?
So yeah, I got some stuff. So but yeah, thanks everybody who's been supporting it because it's been pretty cool to just, you know, laugh along with people that are actually enjoying wrestling and wrestling with crowds and stuff like that. So if you are like us and you're having a hard time, enjoying wrestling with no crowd, just definitely check out this Pain Pig stuff because it's pretty good, if I do say so myself. I also had Super Mega Baseball. And I have two left then. First off is for the past, you know, several weeks, several episodes, I have been kind of doing expose on my new fad favorite sport to watch, now that there's no sports. And, this one, I know it's going to sound like a joke, but I'm genuinely interested in this. So, for those of you who don't know, for those of you who haven't been lifelong Nathan's Hot Dog Eating Contest fans, for the past couple of years, maybe two or maybe might have been 3 years by now, for the past few years, right after the Nathan's Hot Dog Eating Contest, which happens on July 4th, every July 4th for the past I don't know how many years, they've been showing the Johnsonville Bratwursts National Cornhole Championships after the Nathan's Hot Dog Eating Championships. And I've been into this for the past 3 years. So, right when the pandemic started, ESPN did the Ocho gimmick where they play all the fucking fringe sports and they played like another episode of Cornhole. And I was like, they have more episodes? Like they have other episodes that aren't just that one episode. And so that was cool. And so I guess I have YouTube TV. That's my cable provider. And I guess when you set something on YouTube TV to DVR, it just picks up anything for the rest of your life that has those words in it. So, you know, a few weeks ago, I'm like going through my saved shows and I see a new episode of Cornhole is up. And I was like, there's no way there's more Cornhole. And fucking A, there is. They just started a new like season or tour and they've been practicing social distancing. And all the players are wearing masks and they're playing in like empty gyms and stuff. But I know Cornhole is a hard sell for people, so I'm not forcing this on everybody. But I think it comes on Saturdays. I just watch it on DVR on Mondays. But I think every Saturday morning they have Cornhole on ESPN now. I don't know if it's on proper ESPN either. It might be on like ESPN News or something. But I genuinely enjoy watching people play this game. I think I'm late to finding out what Cornhole is. Cause I've only found out what it was like 5 or 6 years ago, I think. It was just one of those things where I think we're at my friend's like he has like his family has like a house near the lake. And I think somebody was like, oh, I brought my cornhole set or something like that. And I was like, I don't know what the fuck that is. And they set it up and I was like, oh, this is like a weird game. And like everybody knew how to play. Like everybody knew what it was. And I was just like, oh, this is something I've never seen before. And it was just one of those things. After I saw it that one time, I saw it fucking at every single bar ever after that. So maybe people have been tired of cornhole because they've had it in their lives forever, but it's still somewhat new to me. And I think it's like, I wish I lived in an area where I could have a backyard and play cornhole, but I don't. So I just have to envy the actual athletes of cornhole. But yeah, so if you're looking for a fringe sport to check out besides wrestling, cornhole every Saturday on ESPN.
As someone who in the old world worked in a pretty sexy office, cornhole has been a staple, as well as like really dusty Wii's and like giant Jenga in like a work culture. And I hate cornhole so much, dude, so I can't really co-sign.
Yeah, I got the vibe it's something for bros. Like, I got that vibe. The people who play it on TV are, like, salt-of-the-earth types, mostly. Like, they're all from parts of your state you've never heard of. there is one attractive woman that plays, though, so that was a surprise, because none of these people are what I would classify as attractive. So I was very surprised by that. They wear jerseys. Like it's pretty chill, man. But it's something I wish I played enough to be good at.
Maybe if older people like played it like in my office, I'd be down with it. But every time I've had to witness cornhole, it was so like aggro. I'm like, dude, there's a pool table right there. Like play something cool. At least you're out here fucking throwing beanbags out here and like treating it like it's like the world championship. It's nuts.
Okay, my last topic, an actual sort of wrestling topic, is a few weeks ago, we were watching AEW, and it was the episode, I know Al doesn't watch, but there's an episode where Brandi
Rhodes... I watch sometimes.
Brandi Rhodes is in the ring, and Jake Roberts comes out, and like, I don't know if somebody knocked her on the ground, or she's already on the ground, I don't know what happened, but basically he gets like over her, and sort of humps her, like a snake basically, and it was real gross. And real sketchy.
Like he slithered on her? Wait, pump the brakes. Okay.
Yeah, he like slithered on her, but he's an old, like immobile man. It wasn't like Randy Orton doing it with grace. It's like an old, gross man doing it. And it looks super sketchy. Like super, I am surprised, like the people on Twitter that bitch about everything did not bitch about this. Like, cause even I was like, this is a little too much. But the person who thought it was really too much was my fucking girlfriend, who was super duper not into this. Like, she was very upset about this. Not in like, oh, they got me. They got me upset. Like, she was like, this is disgusting. This man needs to be fired. And then to add insult to injury, the next week, Jake Roberts comes out and he's like, some people want me to apologize. And then he just starts saying a bunch of sexist stuff about Brandi being in the kitchen and stuff like that. And my girlfriend was super not cool with this. So today I was like, you know, we both work from home. I was working in one room. She was working another room. And she comes out and she's like, I just emailed AEW. And I was like, what are you talking about? And she's like,
what? Are you serious?
She's just been stewing on this for like 2 weeks, I guess. Like she's like, without prompt from me, she was just like, I just emailed them because I want that man fired. And just like, holy shit. Like, Okay. So if Jake the Snake is no longer on television, you have my girlfriend to thank, because she's the one. I don't even know. Like, I didn't ask her anymore. I don't know what email she used or anything. So
I was going to say, was it just Cody at AEWWrestling.com? Like, who did she contact? HR?
Dude, I don't know. It's probably just like she probably went to their website and just contacted their webmaster or something. Like, it's not going to get it to anybody important, but I don't know. So, they're prone. We'll talk about in the Shame Cup. They're prone to give people free tickets for any sort of little thing on Twitter. So maybe I'll be getting some free AEW tickets in the future for my girlfriend's pain.
Good grief. We should have a talk.
Yeah. That's it. That took a lot longer than I thought it would, but we're done.
Up next, the 2020 Shame Cup. A new set of world warriors have come to battle it out in the name of embarrassment. Please stay tuned.
Okay, we are back here on Virtual Pros episode 111, and this is the moment you've been waiting for. This is the Shame Cup 2020. The nominees, the matchups, the preview, and then after we read all these nominees and give you a little description of these matches in a couple days, if you're listening this Thursday night, Friday morning, I think I'm going to start it Sunday or Monday. I think last year I started it Monday, but that was because people had work schedules, so it made sense to start it on Monday, but... And they're bored because they're at work. So it's going to probably start either Sunday or Monday. I'm going to put up some polls on Twitter. You can vote on each match. And then every couple days, I'll refresh it with like the next round. And basically, I forget what the math is, but every couple days it works out where then by next Thursday, we'll have a finalist. And then we'll do like a wrap up episode. But for now, we're going to go over each nominee because, you know, there's only so many letters on Twitter that you can use. So a little of these things need a little more description. If for some reason you are a first-time listener and you did not know what the Shame Cup is, you just happened to land on this episode, we do this every year where we take little shameful pockets of a wrestling fandom and kind of roast them and decide who's the most shameful. I should say the Airport Stalkers, who's a multiple-time winner. I think they won 3 out of 4 times. They have been retired because they're just unstoppable. They're the first inductee of the Hall of Shame, the Virtual Pros Hall of Shame. They can no longer be chosen. I'd also want to give a little honorable mention to this. You know, this field is so stacked this year that we both missed replica belt wearers and used gear buyers, which are two, you know, finalists, like people who have gone far in this tournament, but. There's so many other contestants, we decided to give, you know, a few new ones some stuff. So honorable mention to them, you know, for being trailblazers in the world of shameful wrestling. And, you know, I'm sure they'll be back at some point, but they're taking a little break this year. So, we're just going to go over every single match, describe the nominations and, you know, give our little feelings on who we want to win or who we think's going to win. So the first bracket is shoot reactors versus snitch taggers. Shoot reactors it's tough to say if they've gained or lost steam over the past year, but basically I feel like they lost a little steam over the past year, but it's basically people, and this happens in a lot of different things. It happens in video games and fucking movies. Like there's shoot reactors to everything, but these are people who film themselves either on YouTube or Twitter or something reacting to wrestling. and it's obviously very dumb, and it's very staged, and it's like it always ends in crying, which is not a thing I believe in. If you've listened to other episodes, I don't think you should cry while watching wrestling. And the fact that you can do this on camera on command is ridiculous, and it's disgusting, and it's preying on people's emotions. And I don't know how anybody finds this as a form of entertainment, but people do, and I just think it's very shameful. And they are against snitch taggers. Snitch taggers is very common, again, in pretty much all four. Actually, you know, I don't know. I don't know if this is, I assume it's done in other worlds, like in other kind of worlds of pop culture and stuff, but I don't know. But, you know, it's kind of the person, when you're on Twitter talking shit about a wrestler, you know, anything really, somebody goes in your replies and just tags that wrestler as if, you know, I'm of the philosophy of you probably shouldn't say shit on Twitter or anywhere in social media if you're worried about that getting it back to that person, no matter how big or small they are. But at the other end, it's real annoying when you have some fucking tattletale doing it for you because it's gross and weird. And why should another stranger care that much? And this is, of course, a lot of people nominated Jim Cornette and his cult of Cornette fans as a shame thing. And it's so they're kind of broken up into two categories this year. They're, you know, a lot of the Cornette people are snitch taggers, but it's beyond Cornette people too. It's everybody does it, and it's gross. As far as who I think is going to win and who I want to win, this is actually pretty tough for me because I honestly not even wrestling. Like, I hate when I'm searching for a movie trailer and I hit play and it's like some goober in the corner, like, ooh, 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 like putting his fucking hands on his head. And I'm just like, holy shit, man, this sucks. I hate this. Like, why can't I just see the normal trailer? Why is somebody doing this? So I don't know. I know Snitch Tankers is going to run away with this, but I think I would rather see Shoot Reactors win. But Al, do you have anything to add to this?
This is like a conference final matchup to me personally. with regards to Shoot Reactors, I mean, I think my biggest curiosity when it comes to like people's behavior online is like openly disclosing that whatever has made you cry. Like, who fucking cares? And to take it a step further, to put your phone in selfie mode and record yourself letting people know that whatever you had consumed, like, made you cry, is, like, so dishonest and, like, honestly pretty shameful.
Yeah.
It's gross. Like, yes. For what? Likes and retweets? Like, I gotta let the world know that I cry, that I have these emotions. Like, that's always been such a curiosity to me, mostly because it's just shameful.
Yes.
Snitch taggers, like, this definitely happens in other fandoms. I've seen it happen a lot in rap music, for sure. It's like, did you see what Nicki Minaj said about you, whoever? And I was like, okay. I mean, like, we're on Twitter a lot, and we like, I mean, I like seeing a fight every now and then, it's fine. But for you to, like, not let that happen organically and to, like, tag someone in whatever tweet is about them is kind of weird behavior. Like I had said, this is pretty tough, but I think I would probably go Shoot Reactors since I'm so curious about the behavior.
Yeah.
Just alternate.
Yeah, sure.
Talk about it.
Yeah.
Cool. So the next matchup is Old School Fools versus Crowd Comedians. Like Mike had talked about the Cult of Cornette fans, these would be considered Old School Fools. And I'm also going to lump in, like, Attitude Era enthusiasts. Like, these eras both had, like, their positives, but, like, if there's, like, one telltale sign that, like, someone is washed or, like, peaked at, like, age 14... it's someone that defends, like, old wrestling to, like, the death. And, like, we see this a lot. It's always really awkward to see. So that's what I'd consider an old school fool. Crowd Comedians has been such a juggernaut in these past couple tournaments because Mike and I go to, like, a good amount of live shows. And that's pretty self-explanatory. It's someone who can't really read the room. And they're just, like, swinging for the fences, like, every 5 or 10 minutes to, quote-unquote, pop their section, with just shouting. And it's always pretty embarrassing. For me, I think Crowd Comedians is probably going to win here just because, like, that's in public and, like, your face is out there and it's not a good look.
Yeah. Crowd Comedians was definitely something where I just thought it was like something that would get voted out of the first round, but it made it pretty far last year, and I was pretty shocked by how many people also hate them. I think the Old School Fools thing, if you factor in that it is the cornet type of people, I mean, there are more. It's tough. Two people are very, very, very hated. I never really thought about the aspect that it is probably people who peaked when they were in high school, and that makes it a lot sadder to me, because I didn't even think about it. I just thought it was people who were either just actually old or just like, I don't know. I don't know why you would like wrestling that's just like body slams unless it was to aggravate somebody else. Like, it's just so weird that Jim Cornette has any kind of stronghold on anybody under the age of 50 with this attitude, because it's so strange. And plus, because we are so far removed from that era of wrestling that, like, if you're 40 now, like, you barely remember that type of wrestling. So the fact that he has more people that are on Twitter and social media savvy that are like into this is just so odd to me. I would have to ultimately go with Crowd Comedians, though. I wouldn't be shocked if Old School Fools win, just because, you know, you never know how many people out there actually go to enough wrestling shows where they have to deal with this, but they did make it pretty far last year, so I have a feeling they're going to win again. The next one is kind of an evolution of the Crowd Comedian. It's Front Row Standers versus Fans with Gimmicks. This is my hardest matchup of the first round. This is a real tough one. Front Row Standers was something I think I talked about last year around the Shame Cup, but they were never in it. And it was one of those things that I thought maybe I just noticed and it only bothered me. But I think once I mentioned it, there are so many people that came out of the woodwork saying how much they hate this. Obviously, it's very self-explanatory. These are people who go to wrestling shows and stand in the front row. It's been made even worse by the AEW show, where it seems every episode it's just a whole row of front row people standing up the entire show in most arenas, not every arena, but it happens in most places. And it's just such strange behavior where it's like you buy a front row seat and you immediately become a fucking selfish asshole. And it's so disrespectful, so disgusting. Fans with Gimmicks, though, that's tough. It's a tough, because this covers like a wide array of people. This covers the Frank the Clowns, the Brock Lesnar guys, those types, all the way down to the people who do podcasts or don't even do podcasts, are just on Twitter and they have like heel in their bio. Like, I'm a heel. You better watch out for my edgy opinions, because I'm going to tell it like it is. And if you have something bad to say to me, just fuck off, because I don't care. And it's like, okay, dude, settle down. Again, you'd probably have a horrible, miserable life. Don't take it out on the internet. It's corny. It's really tough to think about who I hate more of these two. I think Front Row Standers are going to win. I think it's going to be very close. I think it's going to come down to like probably like single votes, but I think Front Row Standers are going to take it.
This one's tough too, man. As someone who gets front row at Tokyo Dome all the time, I'm just kidding. I won't start with that. Fans with Gimmicks. I mean, should we start playing like Angel and Devil, like advocate here? They're just trying to make money off this shit, which is like, I mean, not a venue I would go down. Trying to find that place in the business, bro.
See, that's the thing that bothers me. So, okay, Frank the Clown, he's fucking annoying, but he really went for it. He dressed up like a clown. It's fucking stupid. But it worked, I guess. But, yeah, then you have, like, the Brock Lesnar guy on that level who's, like, gimmick is wearing a t-shirt. It's like, dude, if you're really going to be serious about this, like, you got to do more than wear a t-shirt. That's fucking stupid. So, I don't know. I guess I respect Frank the Clown more out of all of these people, but it doesn't mean I like him.
Yeah, I mean, with are they trying to like chase like being Vlad or like a Faith No More guy? And like, you know, they're all weirdly beloved, you know, yeah. Is that what they really want? I'm not sure. I guess in the end, though, like front row standing is just rude. So I think that's just going to win. And like Fans with Gimmicks, I don't really know if they're hurting anybody, but it's just like a weird path to go down, honestly, as a wrestling fan. So
yeah.
I'm with you on this one. Next up is Corona Truth or Wrestlers versus a new entrant, a new powerhouse, I think, the Meat and Creeps. Corona Truth or Wrestlers,
I kind of had a question about this one, Mike. They're not really fans, so you want to just go into why you had selected
this? Well, I think every year we have at least, you know, we had like Vanity Searchers. Like every year we usually have like at least some kind of, you know, some kind of thing for the wrestler. So we're not completely being assholes just to fans of wrestling, but to the wrestlers too. So, you know, this year it's the Corona Truther wrestlers.
Yeah, I mean, self-explanatory. It's people that, you know, kind of first downplayed this as the flu mm-hmm. and just encouraged people to wash their hands. And now they're kind of walking it back. I think TJP and who else? Brian Pillman Jr.
Mm-hmm.
He's part of this as well. And also not a good look. versus, who do we have here? Meet and Creeps. So I think this stemmed from like this Asian guy. He had, I guess in the past, proposed to the pirate princess Kairi Sane and was devastated when he found out that she got married. And he had talked about how he went to the gym and lost all this weight, and he was really like, you know, trying to better himself to be a great husband for the pirate princess. But then if he took a deeper dive, he was just two-timing her because he was doing this to every single wrestler he met at a meet and greets. But he's just an example of a meet and creep. A meet and creep essentially is a person, a fan, that will go to meet and greets and just touch the talent inappropriately in a way that creeps everybody out. For me, meet and creeps is just a powerhouse. I think this advances. Just being a Corona Truther is shitty, but like, meet and creep wrestling fans is like really exclusive, so I think it should get its due.
Yeah, I'm on the same wavelength. There are a lot of people who've done brackets already that are picking Corona Truth wrestlers going all the way to the finals, and I don't know. I think meet and creeps. I think it's a cool name, but I think people on Twitter who don't actually listen to the show are gonna just vote for the thing they know. And but I would also extend it to not just the meet and greet people, but again, this year we saw some guys showing up to Arn Anderson's house unannounced for him to sign a belt. he would fall under that. There's been a lot of women on Twitter report, women wrestlers on Twitter reporting of dudes just writing them to their home addresses. That is an actual illegal thing. Like, that's fucking illegal. You can't do that. There was a show when I was a kid called My Sister Sam where the actress of that got killed by a stalker, and the stalker started by writing her letters saying, I'm going to kill you and shit. And back then there was no laws against that. Like, you could just do that. And they were like, oh, you know, whatever. And then she got fucking murdered, and they were like, okay, we got to take shit like this seriously. So I don't know. And there's people on Twitter, of course, defending it, saying, oh, you know, they're your fans. You should appreciate this. And it's like, man, you guys are fucking psychopaths. So, although I think Coronavirus Truthers are going to win, I definitely think Meet and Creeps should make it all the way to the finals, because they're just another extension of Airport Stalkers, but actually probably more lethal. So, yeah, Meet and Creeps all the way. The next one is Thirst Responders versus Safety Police. I think the internet has finally given a name to Thirst Responders, and it's basically Reply Guys. These are the guys that, respond to, and Simps. That's a new one too. People are starting to call them Simps, but they are just the dudes who reply to every single woman wrestler's tweet, or they might not even reply. They just might just wish them happy birthday or good morning, even though they don't know them in real life. Just shit like that. Just people that are just always up a wrestler's ass, and you know what they're getting at. You know, it's just,
that's a good looking salad. I really like that. Where'd you get that salad from?
Yeah, just stuff like that, where it's just like, stop trying to spark conversation with them. Safety Police is always confusing to people. They always ask what it is, and it's basically the people who care a little too much about a wrestler's health. Like, obviously, there's a level of caring that you should take, but it gets to the point where it seems like if you care this much, maybe you shouldn't watch wrestling, because I don't think they can make it any safer that you're going to approve of. You know, there's been talk of people wearing helmets in the past on Twitter, just stuff like that. So there are people out there who are a little too careful, and they're too concerned about wrestler safety, and it's very cringe. I don't get it. Just watch something else. It's a very niche thing to watch that contains violence. That's the number one appeal to wrestling is violence. So maybe don't watch it. But overall, I'm going to have to give this to the Thirst Responders.
This one's like a really good 4-seed, 5-seed matchup. pretty much on the same, like, power level. I think Safety Police has lost a little bit of heat over the past couple of months, I suppose, because I don't really recall any death-defying shit as of late.
I think now, and I also think now safety is something everybody should be concerned about because of the virus, and everybody's kind of a safety police right now, because not everybody, but a lot of people are like, maybe they shouldn't be wrestling right now. So I think a lot of people who maybe previously didn't are feeling like safety police at the moment.
Yeah, it's that, and like I can't really recall like any spots. Like I know when the first Okada Omega thing happened, and they did the fucking dragon suplex off the top.
Yeah,
where Okada just lands on the top of his head, and people were just like, "This is just too dangerous. What is wrestling become?" It's like they're two willing adults, man. Yeah. Fucking let them do whatever they want. So I think Thirst Responders is going to take this, but I can see either one taking it. The next matchup is Craft Wrestling Enthusiasts versus Ratings Analysis. I didn't realize these were paired up. This is fucking difficult. Ratings Analysis, it's like they signed Kevin Durant to their team this year, with AEW and NXT, going head to head, even though it's not really a battle these days, but you know, self-explanatory. It's someone that really cares about the demographics that are watching these programs, and they just kind of use it to rank on the program that they don't like. I know AEW fans, the hardcore ones, are basking in that 18 to 50 demographic flex right now versus NXT. Versus Craft Wrestling Enthusiasts. This is a tough one to describe, but essentially the way I would do it is there's someone out there that has logged on to Twitter, and they had probably said something along the lines of, you know what, red hair balloons Okada was the best Okada, but we're not ready to have that discussion yet. And it's always super fucking annoying. Like, it's always someone that's like trying to play like a contrarian. We all know the type. I think I'm gonna go with Craft Wrestling Enthusiasts on this one, just because it's just such a dishonest position for the most part. Whereas, like, Ratings Analysis, they for sure care. So that's where I'm at with that one.
The easiest way to say Craft Wrestling Enthusiasts is basically wrestling hipsters, but I hate the word hipster. I think if you use the word hipster, you're hornier than anybody you're describing, because hipster is just, like, a blanket term for things you don't like that you're not into. And but if you get down to it, the heart of the matter, it is a wrestling hipster. It's just a person who does throw a bunch of shit out on the internet, or, you know, even in real life to their friends, and just hoping to grasp onto something that somebody else is going to be like, hey, man, you're right. And it's just always annoying. And I don't know. It's wrestling. You don't have to like the most fringe thing. Like, wrestling is already fringe. Just liking being into independent wrestling is fringe enough. You don't have to be like, oh, you know, actually Test was really good. And it's like, no, I don't think he was. I think it was pretty shit. He wasn't even a wrestler. He's just a big fucking dumb guy. Like, and it's just like, just go with the flow,
damn,
man.
Damn, I like Test, though. I think Test is actually okay, dude. That Shane McMahon brawl at SummerSlam was pretty fucking good, dude. Revisit it.
I guess. But yeah, I mean, like, you know, you are allowed to have your opinions, but when you're just like constantly, constantly hammering these stupid opinions, like, okay, dude, we get it. You can't even drink Budweiser. I know. Like, you get it. I get it. But Ratings Analysts, they really, this was something that's been nominated before that was kind of just like a haha joke, but it's really kicked into full gear this year because people care again. And it's strange that people have fallen for this. Like, obviously Dave Meltzer has to care because it's his job, but ratings don't matter in wrestling. Like, there's WWE is going to make millions and millions of dollars no matter if their ratings are 0 or 27. Like, it doesn't matter. It's they're going to make the same amount of money. TV doesn't work like that. And there's still people like, I'm going to assume they're touched, but I don't know. But there are people who are still like asking Dave Meltzer questions like, oh, you know, fucking TNA used to get these ratings too, and blah, blah, blah. And it's like, dude, that was 20 years ago. There was people hardly had the internet back then. Like, of course, like, there was fucking 10 shows on television. Of course they have had crazy ratings back then. There was only 10 things to watch. Now you have 8 million things and the internet, and 27 streaming services. So I guess people don't understand that, and, but they're out there and they really care. So I have to give it to them just because it's, I mean, it's definitely, Dave Meltzer, who's produced this. Like, I don't think anybody who doesn't know who Dave Meltzer is doesn't care about ratings. So I think he's the problem. I'm surprised he's tricked people into caring about this again, but it's just annoying that it's a thing again, because it wasn't a thing for 20 years. It's just kind of a funny thing that was a fringe thing among like a certain handful of nerds, but it's blown up once again. It's just like it's had its second wave, and I have to say more people are annoyed by ratings analysts right now, so I'm going to give it to them. Next one is promotional hardliners versus free ticket beggars. These are two I feel like I'm definitely going to have to explain. Promotional hardliners is, again, I wouldn't say it's a new thing, but it's a new to wrestling because there hasn't been competition for WWE in so long. But it's been like Xbox versus PlayStation, Windows versus Mac. It's been a thing for the past 10, 15 years in popular culture and on the internet. And now wrestling is that again, where it's AEW versus WWE, because even though we have the most variety we've ever had in our lives and every single aspect of life, people still need to compartmentalize things down to two things because that's all they can handle. And it's just like, I don't care if WWE sucks. I'm just going to like everything they do. Even though they're not being paid by these companies or anything like that, they just swear allegiance. And I mean, that's what politics is like now. Like, people on the internet that know nothing about politics talk about it all day like it's fucking sports. And that's how everything is now. Everything is A versus B. And wrestling's no different. And it's just fucking annoying because it's wrestling. It's a silly, cartoonish thing. And there's so much of it. You don't have to just like one thing. So it's insane that people voluntarily do that. Free ticket beggars is kind of, an extension, an evolution. Last couple of years, we've done like people who beg for retweets and, likes and stuff like that and say, oh, Cody, I'm depressed. My wife left me and I just bought the last Bullet Club t-shirt. Can I get an RT? And then, you know, then they'll be upset about it if the, like, you know, fucking Kenny Omega doesn't take time off of his day to RT this guy or say, hey, what's up, buddy? And it's gotten to the point. This is really niche. It's like really small right now, but it happens. Like, I keep track of this. There's people out there who are using like very sketchy excuses to get free AEW tickets because they know it'll work because they're like the people's company and that's their whole thing. And I'm not saying these people are lying, but there's stuff like, oh, my son was bullied, or, you know, my son just like got better from the sickness and I didn't get tickets in time and now it's sold out and I promised him front row tickets. Cody, can I please have some front row tickets? And Cody's like, yeah, here you go. And it's like, I'm sure the first person who did that was probably sincere. Not so sure about the seventh person who did it. Like, I'm very pessimistic of shit like that. And I think it's extremely exploitational and fucking disgusting. And you shouldn't make your problems somebody else's problems. If you didn't get tickets and you promised somebody, that's on you. That's not on Cody Rhodes. It's not on the Young Bucks. It's not on anybody. It's just gross. I know this is like a polarizing thing. Maybe people are thinking I'm being too hard on these people, but it's fucking disgusting. And it's right up there with meet and creeps for me as far as disgusting exploitational tactics. So I'm giving this to free ticket beggars all the way, even though I know it's like a weird thing that people aren't going to like immediately compute. But I'm in a couple of years, I think people are going to understand what I'm saying.
Aside from adults openly letting people know that Game of Thrones made them cry or whatever, can you imagine, just put yourself in this position, Mike, say that you were thrown like a party when you turned 8 years old and nobody showed up and your sister tweeted at the Chicago Bears like, hey, my little brother Mike, no one came to his birthday party this year. Can you just have Walter Payton just like send him an autograph? Like, things off the internet don't disappear, man. Can you imagine living with this shit a decade later? Like, how much fucking roasting you would get from, like, your peers, perhaps? You probably wouldn't have any peers because this exists. It's horrifying. So any parent, I mean, I'm not one, but if you, like, record your kid crying because they suffered, like, a traumatizing thing and you're, like, adding, like, the Phoenix Suns about wanting some free tickets, or especially fucking AEW... This is a finalist, dude. I'm sorry, but this is the most shameful shit maybe ever. It'd be a dream matchup for me to see this versus Airport Stalkers, yeah. Personally. So horrifying.
Hopefully people are listening and they're getting the picture in their head, because it is I think a lot of people who are in the know have also picked this to go to the finals, but I would definitely like to see it go to the finals also. The last matchup in the first round. Oh, wait. No, it's you. Sorry.
Yeah. Yeah. The last matchup is NSFW, Not Safe for Work, Wrestling Accounts versus Watermarkers. Not Safe for Work, Wrestling Accounts. This is your Alexa Bliss butt worship Instagram account.
According to Wealth, just like looking at Playboy. Don't forget that.
Just like looking at Playboy. Totally fine. That's what it's doing. That's how Playboy was, right? They would just kind of like screenshot a moment where your outfit worked in a way where it wasn't designed to and someone immortalized it. That's how Playboy works on Wealth. Versus Watermarkers. This is a new entrant as well. I think Mike described this as people who will take a GIF or make a GIF of like a 5-second move and put their entire like Twitter handle on there for whatever reason. Vanity, I guess. But in terms of picking a winner, this one's tough. This is a pretty limp matchup, I think. I guess I would go. Well, are you critiquing the people that follow or make these wrestling accounts?
Both,
just the entire ecosystem.
No, I think make. I think that's the real devil right there. The people who make them.
Then I would go with that one for sure.
Yeah, like Al said, it's the people who make like WWE porn, like Diva something. Well, just look at all Welf's follows. Look at J_Welf on Twitter. And look, everybody who follows, and that's probably all the people I'm talking about. It's real sketchy. Like, it's one thing to repost, like, hot pictures that they posted on their Instagram. It's weird, but it's not, like, crazy. But when you're, like, doing, like, going through a video frame by frame to see a little, like, little, you know, little maybe vagina slip out, you know, something like that, you're just like, that's something you should be locked up for, actually. Not you shouldn't be posting on the internet. You should just be locked up immediately. The Watermarkers thing, as Al said, this is something where I kind of meant, I didn't mention, I saw somebody else mention on Twitter, and I kind of chimed in and started this little thing, but that's besides the point. But it was something that I thought I was just being an irrational old man, and only I hated this. And then, you know, somebody mentioned it, and then I mentioned it to other people, and it seems like everybody hates this. So I was very happy that I was like, oh, everybody else notices this too and fucking hates it. Yeah, the best way I can say is it's like when you were like fucking 8 and your mom made you write your name on your Nintendo game, but you want to do it voluntarily. And then like, it's like that. And it's just like, and then like 30 years later, you go to like a vintage game store and you can only buy games where somebody wrote their names on them. You're just like, cool, this is fucking great. This is what I wanted. I wanted this thing that was fucking ruined by some other idiot. Or, and me and Al's cases and people our age, like, imagine just either trading a tape or going to highspots.com, you know, putting down your hard-earned cash that you spent like 38 hours building up, setting it away for like Super J Cup, and taking 2 weeks to get to you. You pop in the tape, and right in the middle of the whole entire tape for 4 hours, it just says highspots.com. And you're just like, what the fuck? Like, what the fuck is this? And they have the right. I want to say they have the right to do it, but they have more of a right because they're actually supplying you with something. These are people who are just making GIFs and posting pictures on the internet. And it's like, dude, you did fucking nothing. Like, you did absolutely nothing. And you're trying to take credit for doing absolutely fucking nothing. And like, I understand. You don't want like other accounts poaching your stuff, but if you don't want other accounts poaching your stuff, do something that actually is creative then. Like, don't just post fucking GIFs. Like, it's not creative. So I don't know. I hate these people. I don't think they don't bother me personally. I just think it's like, it just depresses me because it's just like another thing that makes me think like we are just like creatively bankrupt as people. That we just want credit for the most mundane things, and this is just another mundane thing. But people who make porn accounts of people slipping out of their outfits is just that's a little creepy. So even though I probably deep down hate Watermarkers more because I see it more during the day, I'm gonna have to go with the Not Safe for Work wrestling accounts.
I mean, to speak up on scanning, like, I mean, when we started the virtual pros thing, like, I mean, I would scan these photos. And I knew it was good, like a good way to get people to look at the account and possibly follow. But I feel like anytime you make that account and you're worried about people stealing it, like once it's on the internet, it's not yours anymore for the most part.
Yeah.
So I never really tripped on just making people like aware that Al scanned this. Mm-hmm. He scanned this fucking rare great Muta ad. Who cares at the end of the day? Like, I thought it was cool and people should see it. I certainly wouldn't, you know, go the extra length to fucking tag myself personally, but that's just me. But anyway, that was the 2020 Shame Cup. When is voting going to start, Mike?
I would say either this Sunday or Monday. We'll see. I know it's a, like, it's a holiday, but who fuck, like, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter that we're having a holiday right now, really. So I don't know. It's, but I would say either Sunday or Monday. Just keep your eyes peeled on Twitter.
Up next, the world famous mixtape with Owen Hart, the Dynamite Kid. Who else do we have here? Koji Kanemoto, Sabu, and a bunch of other fools. Please stay tuned.
Yo, it's your day, baby. We got this nigga tied down right now.
Wait till I get there.
Yo, you ain't gonna make it out of here, bitch. What the fuck are you thinking, nigga? Hold him up, yo, nigga.
You already do this, nigga.
I got his ass, I got his ass.
You don't really want none of this though. I let them know from the get-go. See y'all is a bit slow. Try and come with the hits, but they miss though. Retaliate, make them drop like a 6-4. Why you hate? Cause I didn't give a shout out. Or the way that my shine turned a spot out. You think you can rhyme, but you not out. Or the way we drop the top when it's hot out. Anyone, you can pick and choose. While y'all stagnant, my niggas stick and move. My name say it all, ain't got shit to prove. My whole mental ain't shit to lose. You can snooze if you wanna, but you wanna be a goner. Please forgive me, your honor. But that fool tried to take was mine. That's the reason why I had to utilize my nine. Otherwise, she could be right here now. Talking about how the clip done bit his style. Back in the day, how we did him foul. Or how we done switch, how you like me now. And anything else that them haters may say. Come how you want, just bring it the right way. Mayday, what they gon' say? Coming to their hood, the clip from Tam A.
Okay, we are back here on Vrtl Pros episode 111. If you are a new listener, this is our world famous mixtape segment. Each episode, we both pick a couple matches that we put on our YouTube playlist that you can find by searching Vrtl Pros mixtape or just following VRTL Pros on YouTube. And then we put these matches on the playlist and we talk about them every episode. That's what we do. And my first match of the night is Bob Sapp versus Razor Ramon HG from Hustle from, I think, 2007. I forgot to write the date down. I think it's 2007. Razor Ramon HD also used to be known as Razor Ramon Hard Gay, but I don't think you could say Hard Gay anymore. I don't think people like the sound of that anymore. So it's just HG. I kind of put this on the match because I was doing like the Pain Pig stuff and I've been watching a lot of Hustle stuff. And I just really, between putting that stuff together and doing this Shame Cup thing, I didn't really want to turn my brain on too hard this episode, picking matches, and somebody had recommended this and I was like, this is an easy, quick match. And I think it might be the first Hustle thing we've put on the mixtape in these past 5 years. So it's just something I want
to. It's so hard to find. So yeah. I can see why.
Yeah. That's the thing. Like back in the golden age of the internet, like maybe 5 years ago, around when we started this podcast, actually, there was like some page that had every single Hustle event on YouTube, and then they just like all disappeared. And since then, it's been fucking just tumbleweeds out there for Hustle. So, I think that's just something that people need to be aware of, and try and search for, because it was just like this magical thing that lasted for a few years, basically from early to mid to there, actually mid to late 2000s. It was a promotion, I guess. I don't know if it was owned, but it was run by Nobuhiko Takada. And it was like this weird, like very soap opera style comedy, weirdo science fiction promotion. But it had all of these wrestlers in it that were known as serious hard men, like a Kawada, Mark Coleman, just like, you know, a lot of kind of shoot style wrestlers, stuff like that. And Ishii was in there for a minute, like Masato Tanaka, a lot of these hard men wrestlers, but they were doing Bob Sapp. They were all doing these kind of, you know, silly, weird science fiction or just goofy, campy gimmicks. And I think the thing that really set Hustle over the edge for me was that not only were they doing these, because there's things existed like Michinoku Pro and Osaka Pro and stuff on that lower level of doing like a lot of comedy. But this was done in like huge arenas in like, you know, with huge, huge crowds. And it was just like this gigantic spectacle with all, I wouldn't say effects, but, you know, it was very theatric, like, you know, crazy entrances, all this shit. I don't even know how they ever financed this. I would assume it was probably dirty money, and this is, like, all sponsored by the Yakuza or something like that. I don't know. I would love some kind of documentary on Hustle, but it was just this amazing thing that existed for a few years. And I don't think it could ever be replicated. And I just don't want it forgotten because it was a really magical kind of wrestling promotion. As far as this match, it's a match. I also wanted to talk about it because of a Bob Sapp who was kind of forgotten. I mean, you know, people, when you say Bob Sapp, they know the name, but I don't think a lot of people realize like 10, 15 years ago, this phenomenon that was going on with Bob Sapp where he became like Michael Jackson in Japan. And at the time, everybody knew, like, it was talked about in America, like, there's this man named Bob Sapp, and he's, like, the biggest thing in Japan. Like, this was covered in, like, mainstream news. And it, you know, obviously it's not like that anymore. It's just this fad that went away. But, you know, there was a minute where Bob Sapp, this kind of whatever MMA guy, was the most popular thing in Japan, and it was crazy. And, so he would main event these hustle events because he was the fucking biggest star in Japan. Obviously, Razor Ramon Hardgate, HG, was kind of a comedy act, you know. He's kind of a flamboyant guy. I don't know why his name was Razor Ramon. I don't know if I even want to find out. I just like it that he took somebody else's name and added Hardgate to it. But this is just like a comedy match. It's a big monster beating up a tinier guy. He's not super tiny, but, you know, he's obviously tinier. There's a part where Razor Ramon face fucks Bob Sapp for like a really long time. That's pretty sweet. That's something I don't think you see every day. So that was pretty cool. I also wonder, cause this, I wouldn't say this match is like 50-50, but, Razor Ramon gets a lot more offense in that than you would think. Cause he's fighting Bob Sapp, who's this huge monster. But, I do wonder, even this is such a comedy promotion, if there were like nerds back in the day that were like, oh, Razor Ramon got too much offense in that match. This is unbelievable. And like, we're really upset about it in this fucking silly match. But yeah, I just picked it so I could talk about Hustle for a minute. I think Al brought it up last episode where people like scoffed at Minoru Suzuki doing a match with Orange Cassidy, not realizing that he has a long history of comedy. And I think a lot of people hold a lot of Japanese wrestlers in some kind of high hard man regard. And kind of forget that they all are kind of goofy and are willing to do goofy stuff. And that's a Hustle in a nutshell. It was a lot of hard wrestlers doing goofy shit.
To speak on the ownership of Hustle, I think Dream Stage Entertainment was their name. They owned Pride.
Oh, okay.
And I believe they also owned Hustle. So your Yakuza fantasies are actually true, I think.
Yep, that makes sense.
So, one of my notes was I was supposed to link you to like this clip I saw like 10 years ago, where Razor Ramon HG, he visits the Yahoo Japan headquarters, and he actually lists like a used hat that he had, worn, for auction. And I think it went for like $300, but, it's incredible. It's translated. It's very problematic in 2020, but, you know, cancel me. I laughed. It was so fucking funny. Did you watch this at all or no?
No, I saw you posted. I didn't watch it yet, though.
Oh, it's so good. But, you know, since we started doing shirts, like, for the past couple years, like, I'd always kind of, like, brainstorm or, like, kind of test myself. Like, if I had to make a shirt of X, what would I do? And one of those X's was Tenryu. And I was like, that's kind of a weird one to pull off on a shirt. And, I know you have the same stance when it comes to wearing swear words. but there's a clip of him, in this clip where, there's a graphic of him and, the word fuck underneath his head. And so that actually might be the next virtual pro shirt is, Tenryu saying fuck. That makes me laugh a lot, actually. So, spoiler alert. That's a new shirt right there. Some curse words. But yeah, not really much to say about this match, except that Bob Sapp, he hits, HG with a drop kick, and it looked pretty good. hope Mike's girlfriend's not listening, but I also had the thought that, we need someone actually in 2020 to have some, very serious, humper offense. I think it'd be a good look. It's very different. So maybe we'll bring that back perhaps. And also we need someone, to have a mask with some attached headwear. I think it works out for everybody, honestly. Like, Super Kolo, it worked out for him. Curry Man, also. So, if you're a luchador, or if you just want a cool mask, I suggest just, like,
getting a Kangol sewed onto it or something. I think it looked cool. But overall, I thought this was a pretty cool watch. My first pick of the night is Dynamite Kid versus Owen Hart, Stampede Wrestling 7/28/1989. So, if anyone is curious right now, about my hair, Owen Hart and I, we have the same thing going on, and it's annoying. I showered and it was my condition day, and so that means my hair is extra straight, and that thing is down to my chin now, dude. It's fucking crazy. So I might be close to breaking right now and shaving my head. We'll see. So this clip, it opens up with promos from both Owen Hart and Dynamite Kid. Owen, he threatens that he's going to make a mess of Dynamite Kid's face because he's been training all week. It was a pretty good bar. And to come to think of it, this might be like maybe the second time I've ever seen Dynamite Kid cut a promo. But he has like a really like Ahmed Johnson like intensity on the microphone in this clip. And I liked it a lot. It was pretty cool. This is clip though. And also like the last match, not a whole lot to say match wise, but this was billed as a street fight. And I don't see any knee pads over the jeans. I don't see any weapons. I did see some blood, which is appreciated. But my only takeaway is like, how insane do you think it would have been to see someone take a pile driver onto the outside in 1989? Yeah. Like, I can't really think of like a modern equivalent in like today's age. Like maybe if someone did like a Dragon Rana off a ladder, like, I don't know. But like, either way, like this was pretty okay. And I think I'd want to watch more of the Stampede because, I do like the old man aesthetics of it. What'd you think, Mike?
If you want to watch more Stampede, I'll give you a little spoiler alert. Maybe you watch a little Pain Pigs number 4 on Monday at 9 o'clock.
And hell yeah.
You might catch a little, but, so yeah, Owen Hart gets this promo and he's like, in the beginning, he's like, I lost money taking this match. And I'm like, what the fuck is he talking about? And I guess he worked it in that he quit the WWF to come and fight the Dynamite Kid in Stampede Wrestling, which is pretty cool. Adds a little nuance to the wrestling. But yeah, because I didn't know what the fuck he was talking about. Because he's like, I turned down all these contracts. And then he's like, from other wrestling federations. And I'm just like, oh, I get it. This is when he got fired after the quitter at whatever, after when he was the Blue Blazer at first. But that was a pretty cool promo. But yeah, like Al said, and speaking of Ed's email of cocaine promos, here we go with the Dynamite Kid. First off, he looks cool as hell, like a dude who does cocaine. He has a shirt off, and he's wearing these cool aviator shades, and he looks fucking awesome. And yeah, he just has this crazy Cockney accent. He's like, whoa, 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 and it's fucking great. And he sounds angry. He sounds like the meanest dad, and you're like, man, I don't want to fuck with this dude. He's fucking crazy. Just that, on that alone, I want to see some more fucking Dynamite Kid at Stampede stuff, even though this match wasn't the greatest. But and it's just coincidental because one of the High Spots auctions today was like an old Dynamite Kid, that kind of old timey wrestling DVD autographed, but it was like $50 with the book and like another 8x10, and I was like, that's a lot of my price range. But but yeah, I want to check more of that stuff out. I'm gonna assume these promos were done from like a different event, and then they spliced in this match either on this episode or this dude did it on YouTube or whatever, because Dynamite Kid goes from being shirtless in this promo to wearing a shirt in this match, and that's a real weird move. If before a match you're shirtless, and then you're like, oh man, I got the street fight coming up, I better put on this tiny tank top. That's a weird move. So I assume this is like a different day, but I just noticed that Canadian Stampede canvas might not be the most the most beautiful canvas, but it has its charm. It has like a lot going on. It's kind of unique. It has stars all over it that looks like you could like place the wrestlers on. Like, I don't know. It's definitely a unique look as far as canvas design goes. But overall, as Al said, this is not the best match. It's kind of clipped to shit. I haven't watched very much Stampede at all, but I think all I come across is always like cut down to 5 minutes. So I'm assuming that's just how their TV was, but I don't know. My last match of the night is Koji Kanemoto versus Sabu from New Japan Pro Wrestling 1995, Pro Wrestling Dontaku. I chose this match for a couple reasons. I saw this match on a list of shit I was looking at, and I was like, maybe I should put this on one of these Pain Pigs things. And then I Googled it, and there are a lot of unkind words about this match on the internet. And then I was like, I don't care what people on the internet say. And then I looked at the quality on YouTube, and it looked like shit. And I was like, I don't care that much. I'm not going to put it on. I'll just put it on regular old Virtual Pros, and we'll talk about it. Because if it's shitty, if it's actually shitty, I do want to talk about it. The first thing is, I haven't seen, I think all of the Sabu New Japan I've seen has come from this show. And I think it's just two other matches. So this is the third match of Sabu New Japan I've seen. And I don't think those other two matches included his theme song, which is fucking awesome. He has an awesome theme song in New Japan. He has a crazy entrance, because I guess they just had tons of money to blow back then. So it's pretty sweet seeing Sabu's crazy elaborate entrance, because he's not a man known for even being in wrestling promotions that you could describe as elaborate. So it's worth it. The mission is worth it right there, just seeing his entrance. This is video quality is definitely fair to poor. This is fair to poor video quality. It looks like they're wrestling in the Dust Bowl or something. It's very dusty looking. With that said, though, the audio is crisp and it's very strange. I didn't rewind it, but I'm pretty sure there's a part where Koji Kanemoto gets Sabu in some sort of leg lock or crab or something like that. And then the ref is, asking him if he wants to give up. And I'm pretty sure Sabu's saying, maybe, maybe, maybe. If he's really saying maybe, that is amazing. And if you're a wrestler out here listening to this, you need to steal that. When somebody has you in a submission hold, just start saying maybe, maybe, because that's fucking great, man. That was a great spot. There's also a part where they slap each other, and I don't think that's fake. Those aren't fucking fake slaps, man. Sabu also gives out some fucking forearms that don't look fake either to the face. So I think this match gets a little sideways. This is also something that kind of, to bring it back to the Shame Cup, kind of ties it into the watermarker thing, but really abstractly. But When I Googled this, all of the reviews I saw for this match were very, very negative. They all came from a certain point in time, 15 years ago, from message boards, but it was this match sucks because Sabu stinks. Cause that was kind of the thinking wrestling fans, kind of opinion on Sabu always was, oh, he stinks. He just does these spots and he stinks otherwise. Once you graduate to serious wrestling fan, man, you have to think Sabu stinks. So once I saw those, I was like, yeah, maybe, maybe they aren't. Maybe this match is actually good because people back then just had this thing about Sabu. And I think, I'm not going to say this is the best match ever, but I do think this match is pretty good. And that's another thing that pisses me off is about the internet is just people are going to Google this match for the rest of time, and it's always just going to be those opinions. And then, people are going to Google Sabu, and they're going to have these opinions about Sabu without being able to check it out. And it's just stuff like that, that we should just try and preserve everything to the best of our abilities without ruining it. And so putting your own tag on something that's not yours, or just I don't know. I just see bad things about the internet in the future. And people's opinions being swayed by just the only thing existing is message board posts. I'm going to say it, the ending kind of sucks. It comes out of nowhere, this match. But outside of that, I thought this match was pretty decent. I was expecting it to be very bad, the way it was described on the internet, but it's pretty good. And I think, I think it has some real-ass violence in it, or they're at least pretty good at pretending they're really hitting each other. But I'm not going to say you need to run out and watch it, but it was enjoyable to watch. But what do you think, Al?
We have a lot of the same notes, but I will speak on 2005 opinions on wrestling. And I feel like that was a time, maybe 2002 through 2005, where people just demanded perfection in wrestling moves. They wanted every wrestler to fucking wrestle like John Gresham. And John Gresham is cool, but there is that kind of point in every wrestling fan's life where you kind of like what you like and then you want to get serious about it. But then, spoiler alert, Mike and I, you just kind of appreciate people being out there, and Sabu, yeah, like, is unfuckwithable, honestly. So to me, you can never slander the man personally just because I was there in 97 and now. But I wanted to ask you something. Do you remember, like, when and where you were when you actually first heard Sabu say, like, real words?
Oh, yeah, I do. It was fucking outside of there. I remember there was that promo on ECW where he, like, just screamed Taz, I think. And I was like, whoa. But there was the first time I heard him speak all, like, a lot of words is that first shoot interview we did. And it was, like, a big deal. It was right around when they did that WWF ECW pay-per-view. And I remember, like, I heard about it. I was like, oh, so-and-so, they're doing the shoot interview. And I downloaded it from a torrent, and I was just like, my mind was blown. So I was, you know, I was pretty old by then. It wasn't like I was a kid still. It took like me a long time to finally hear Sabu talk.
Dude, same exact thing, man. And like it would happen like years after, yeah, like my Sabu fandom. And like, you know, I really bought into that madman mystique known as Sabu. And I know like when I first saw, I think it was on like, that Rising Sun blog back in the day where like they announced that he got married. I'm like, wait, what? Sabu's a fucking madman. What the hell? He was like dressed up in Japanese garb and like he was wearing like a Japanese woman. I'm like, wait a goddamn minute. That's not Sabu like. And then when the shoot interview dropped, like he just sounded like a flea market dealer.
Yeah,
and wow. I didn't feel like my whole childhood was a lie, but it was fucking mind-blowing when that happened. That might be, like, the most illusion-breaking moments in wrestling for me personally. But, yeah, I know, like, when and where I was. It was probably, like, when was that shoot interview? Like, it was late, like, 2009, 2010.
Oh, no, right? It wasn't that
maybe
late.
A little earlier?
Yeah, I think it was, like, 2005 or 2006. It was...
Okay, like, around that time.
Yeah.
But still, like, I had my Sabu fan blog in 1998, and to hear this shit fucking 8 years later, like, yeah, what the fuck? But yeah, like you had said, this is, like, by far the nicest Sabu entrance ever. But a crucial mistake, he didn't rock the head wrap, dude.
No.
What the fuck? Right? Just me? I don't know. But you talked about it as well. In the middle of the match, Kanemoto, he's putting some spice on these open-hand slaps. And Sabu doesn't like it very much, and he fucking hits him with some forearms. And then Kanemoto chilled out, which was pretty funny to me. And then later on, Sabu, he does what my biggest fear is when watching someone do a moonsault, and that's when like their knee hits like a prone opponent in the head.
Mm-hmm.
And sure enough, that happened. And now that I think about it and talk through it, maybe he did that on purpose. It's because he fucking hates Koji Kanemoto. But overall, like straight up, you know, wrestling Sabu, the first half, it wasn't bad at all. It was pretty good. And I like this match a lot. The last match of the night is Katsuyori Shibata versus Jun Akiyama, Wrestle 1 Grand Prix, 8-4, 2005. So I have no clue on what the backstory is, but this clip, it starts off with a Shibata running into a match that's taking place in a Ricky Pro, and he starts beating the shit out of an old man Ricky Choshu, which is pretty fucked up, man. Like, who beats up on the elderly like that? It's pretty mean. But I guess this was like a promo package to just highlight how much of a bastard Shibata was in 2005. I think this is during the time he defected from New Japan. And went on to have a very mediocre MMA career. But this event, the Wrestle 1 Grand Prix, it had some pretty good people in it. Like Minoru Suzuki was there, Don Fry, Bob Sapp. And I'm a sucker for tournaments, and I know you are too, Mike. So I'm pretty interested in how this turns out, so I might have to add some more matches. I think this match was originally... recommended by my brown brother, Jordan, aka Buttery Heat. And, I could see why, because this match, it starts off with one of the hottest, beginnings, I've ever seen on the mixtape as a Shibata. He, laces Jun Akiyama with a kick to the head that immediately busts, Akiyama's head right open. And then we're off to the fucking races. Like, they start brawling, into the crowd. And Akiyama's putting some fucking stink on these chair shots on the outside.
which is fucking wild. And from there on out, and for like my money, this like might be one of the best like sub 13 minute matches I've ever seen in my life. It's a must watch on my end. Like Akiyama at the end, he destroys Shibata with a clutch exploder, and I loved it. Some definite pain pigs right here. drop what you're doing and watch this. What'd you think?
So I haven't seen a whole bunch of old Shibata matches outside of, you know, the current popularity of New Japan. And every one I've seen has been good, but it's just kind of been whatever. Like, it's been good, but it's not been amazing. So I was just like, yeah, you know, this match will probably be fine. And then, as Al alluded to, so that intro, it's pretty long. It's like 2 or 3 minutes of this video at least. And it's goes into like Al said, he goes in and he beats up Rei Choshu. And then it's just like Aki, like a talking segment with Akiyama, a talking segment with Shibata. I don't speak Japanese. So I don't know what's really going on. And I kind of get the vibe from the clip and them showing like their birth dates on the screen that this was probably some sort of like, you know, young punk, like, young pup versus some old hound type of deal going on. So I'm like, okay, I get it. So that the stage was set for that. Also, before we get into the match, there's a very like American video game sounding announcer that announces their names. And he says, Jun Akiyama and Katsuori Shibata. And it's pretty cool. I like that. I'm assuming everybody in the tournament gets their name announced like that. So I wouldn't mind seeing the whole thing. And as Al alluded to, this starts out with one of the most brutal, real ass kicks to the head I've ever seen a wrestler fucking take, man. It is crazy wild. Like, it is something where I am surprised that this is the first time I'm seeing this. I don't know how this hasn't been a watermark GIF by this point. Holy, this is going to be the first GIF I think I watermark. I'm going to make a GIF of this and put it up right after we're done. Virtual Pros, right across where he kicks him in the head. I'm just going to put it right on Jun Akiyama's forehead.
Right on the cut, dude. Just right on the fucking open wound, dude. Virtual Pros, right there.
Yeah, and then, yeah, if you are the biggest pessimist on earth and you're still like, oh, that was fake, he fucking slapped his leg. He's immediately bleeding from a fucking kick. Like, that's how hard he got fucking hit. And then, as Al said, it tumbles to the outside. And he is delivering some fucking, Akiyama's delivering some pain to Shibata with these chairs. He's just throwing them. And, I don't know what to say. They're either the greatest wrestling actors on earth or that kick to the head wasn't supposed to maybe be that spicy. And he's like, I'm going to fuck you up, dude. Like, that fucking hurt. Cause he's really throwing these chairs at him. But I mean, just if you didn't catch that beginning and didn't decipher it, if you just turned this match on, you would think these guys had like the fucking most years long blood feud ever. Like as hard as they're going to the beginning for some first round match to a goddamn tournament. And these guys are, this legitimately is sold as if they're trying to kill each other for like the first half of this match. It is fucking brutal. It is kind of in reverse because for whatever reason, the last third is them doing holds and it's like, huh, like, you started off pretty hot. Like, this is one of the most realistic wrestling matches I've ever seen in my life. And then you're going to break it down to holds, but it works because they're fucking gross. I don't know. The air conditioning must have not been in that building, or they must not have it because they're super sweaty. The ref is sweaty. There's blood spots on his fucking shirt from Akiyama's head. It's fucking gross looking. And then, you know, there's the finish and, it is a great, like, I would say this is a perfect match. This is 5 stars all the way. I am shocked that this isn't some kind of heralded match. This is, I would say run out and go see this immediately.
Speaking of spicy, is this the clip that had the fucking, Mexican cup of noodle deal commercial at the end of that shit?
Yeah, I think it is this one. Yeah, for like a second.
Dude, I hella need that in my life right now. It really cheered me up. But anyway, that was episode 111 of the World Champion Sound. Oh, and even mentioned it. If you're a new listener to this shit, you can find the mixtape by typing in Virtual Pros Mixtape in YouTube. It'll pop right up.
I said it. Now you're anyway, the one fucking up.
Hey, man. Trying times, dude. If you want to participate, email us at virtualpros64@gmail.com. Twitter, Instagram, VRTLPros. Any last words, Mike?
Hey, thanks for listening. Tell your friends to listen. And please, if you go outside, wear a mask. Don't be a piece of shit.
See you guys in 2 weeks.